It is not getting any better here in the state of Florida. Florida reporting yesterday more than 12,600 cases. And new this morning, we're learning about a big issue that's been lurking under the radar, and that is the need for medical personnel. We just learned this morning from Jackson Health that 200 of their medical personnel are out with COVID-19. The positivity rate for all of the employees that they tested was 23%. That's why it's no surprise that Governor Ron DeSantis announced yesterday that he's upping the number of nurses that he's deploying across the state to 3,000. Here's the reality on the ground in Miami-Dade County. The positivity rate here is 28%. When it comes to hospitalizations, the number of hospitalizations of patients with COVID-19 is 2,000. When you look at that number, the percentage increase in the past 13 days, it's up 68%. The number of ICUs needed, 69%. The number of ventilators needed, 109%. Right now, there are 200 people on ventilators in Miami-Dade County. I just checked the number of ICU hospitals across the state that are at capacity with zero hospital ICU beds available is 48. Eight of them are right here in Miami-Dade County. Now, as leaders refuse to roll back any of their reopening plans, the frustration from residents is boiling over. I was at a Governor Ron DeSantis press conference yesterday when Tomas Kennedy interrupted the governor with this. Take a listen.
So I think the
Over 4,000 people have died, and you are blaming the protesters. You guys have no plan, and you're doing nothing. Shame on you.
Now, I talked to Kennedy after he was escorted by security. And Allison, he said he was frustrated, that he wanted his voice to be heard, that he's tired of the failed leadership, and that one simple thing that Governor Ron DeSantis could start doing is mandating masks statewide.
Rosa, thank you very much.
All right, joining us now, CNN Chief Medical Correspondent Dr. Sanjay Gupta. And Sanjay, let's start with Florida, because some of the news and information we're just getting from Rosa out of Florida is alarming. She says 48 ICU hospitals are now at capacity. That number was 35 yesterday when she reported it. The Miami Herald this morning reporting something that really got my attention, which is that the Jackson Health System, which is one of the biggest health systems in the state, says that they've seen a 100% increase in the number of patients 80 years old and older. So it is now beginning to affect seniors, this surge there. How concerned are you about Florida this morning?
Well, it's very concerning and, you know, sadly, very, very predictable. You know, we have seen this for some time. You can predict how this virus is going to behave. It did seem to affect this younger demographic. And I think we took some solace in the fact that younger people are less likely to get ill. And that remains true. I will say that we have learned a few things with regard to taking care of critically ill patients over the last several months. Ventilators aren't the panacea that we thought they were initially. Simple things like proning patients, putting them in different positions, can make a big difference. There are certain medications like steroids which can help. But, you know, it's very concerning because, you know, if you look overall at the death rates, who are the most vulnerable patients, and even go back to that early data coming out of Wuhan several months ago now, this has held up to be the same, that we know that the elderly patients are going to be more vulnerable. We also know that people who have certain pre-existing conditions are going to be more vulnerable, and that's what we're seeing in the intensive care units. I talked to Rosa for a while yesterday. I talked to a couple of public health officials in Florida as well. The other thing that I think is concerning, and you guys mentioned this earlier in the show, but you know, when we talk about hospital resources, one of the things that we think about oftentimes is just basically square footage and beds and stuff, like ventilators. But when you start to have a significant number of personnel who are affected by this, respiratory therapist, for example, it becomes one of the rate-limiting steps here. How do you take care of the patients if the hospital personnel, the healthcare personnel themselves, either are getting sick or you just don't have enough? That's part of the surge capacity as well, and that could be a real limiting factor in Florida, in Texas, and other places as well.
That's when things got really alarming here in the tri-state area. When back in March, when all of the hospital workers started getting sick, that's when it was like how are we going to get out of this? I mean, when they, right. when colleagues are caring for each other, and, you know, Sanjay, as you point out, I guess we should just brace ourselves for the death rate to begin spiking, because we were in that respite where, okay, I guess it's just younger people now getting sick. I guess it's just 20-something-year-olds, but now they're infecting their grandparents. And so does that mean that we should prepare ourselves for a spike in the mortality rate?
Yeah, I mean, sadly, Allison, as I've said so many times on this show, you know, I get no joy in talking about this. I mean, these are terrible things, but sadly, very predictable as well. Let me show you something that we showed on this program back in March. This goes back to 1918. And, you know, there are lessons to be learned throughout our lives and certainly throughout history. If we go look at what happened in 1918, or if we have that graph, we know that there was this first wave of infections and subsequently deaths. But it was really the second wave that ended up being so problematic. Where are we right now? If you look at this graph, where are we in the course of this pandemic? Well, we're still sort of in that first wave over there, to the far left of the screen. We haven't really had a second wave. We haven't had the luxury of a second wave because we never really got out of the first wave. We're still spiking in this first wave. But the concern, Allison, exactly to your point, and again, very predictable, unless we do something about this, is that the second wave, because you have not only more virus now in the community, far more than we had in February and March, but it's predictably going to start affecting older people. And the hospital capacity ultimately is what really changes that mortality rate. The virus itself, you know, if someone were to ask, look, you put 100 people in a room, they all get exposed to the virus, what is the mortality rate here? The reality is we still have a hard time answering that question, because it's so affected by how likely someone is to be able to get hospital care, what kind of care they're going to get, all of that. Some people said it's around 1%. 1% of people who get infected will die from this. But if you don't have enough hospital capacity, you're going to have preventable deaths, and that starts to drive up the mortality rate. If you do the calculations on the right side of the screen, it's somewhere between 3 and 5%, much higher than it should be.
It's interesting, Sanjay, that California stepped up and is beginning to close down some of the things that they'd opened. They also announced the schools in San Diego and Los Angeles counties will not be reopening physically in the fall. California is in a little bit of a different place than Texas and Arizona and Georgia and Florida. It's still bad there, but their positivity rate is actually only half of what those other states are. So in some ways, they're doing this before or in a place that is better off than Texas right. or Florida right now.
Yeah, I mean, you know, it's interesting, John, because it's all the context, right? I mean, I think Florida was earlier in terms of when they started talking about shutdowns previously, and I think a lot of the country was thinking, really? You're going to think about shutting things down? Is that really necessary? And then it became obvious, you know, abundantly necessary and abundantly clear that it needed to be done. I think we're sort of seeing the same thing here as well. I do worry that even though they are ahead of this compared to places like Texas, you know, if you don't get ahead of the curve very quickly with this virus, you're behind it. And I worry about that even in Florida. I will say that, you know, we can identify the biggest sort of contributors to spread. And there's no question that indoor gatherings that are unmasked because people are eating and drinking, such as restaurants and bars, closely clustered together, those are going to be the biggest source of super spreading events. There's no question about that. I think the question now for California and for, you know, several states now around the country is, can you do these sort of surgical strikes or these minimally invasive procedures as opposed to going into a more full shutdown mode? Nobody wants to go into a full shutdown mode. I get that. But is that sort of aggressive therapy going to be what's necessary, you know, over the next several weeks in order to really stop the transmission of this virus, to sort of just stamp it out for a period of time so that we can get our arms around it again?
Sanjay, I feel like we could ask you about antibody tests or research, I guess, every single day, because it seems that every single day we get new, different, conflicting information about whether you develop antibodies, whether they protect you from the virus, how long they last. So the latest research says what, something like 20 to 30 days they start dissipating?
Right. And I will tell you this, we have some reporting that we've been doing a lot of reporting in this area. We have some more that's going to come out this week. We saw these studies that basically said that they were measuring antibodies in people who had been exposed to the virus and did see dissipation, even disappearance of the antibodies after 20 to 30 days. I think the real question is, so what does that mean, right? What does that really mean for the average individual? Couple things to just keep in the mind. One is that, you know, the United States, and we've been keeping a close eye on this, we haven't really seen stories, examples of reinfections, right? There were some anecdotal reports that came out of South Korea. But in the United States, if it were true that you simply lost protection 20 to 30 days after exposure, I think by this point we would have seen definitive reinfection rates. And we really haven't seen that. So that's something to keep in the back of the mind. Also, I think just more subjectively, if you are someone who's been exposed to the virus and you recovered, even if your antibodies have dissipated, you've already demonstrated now that you've been exposed to the virus and recovered. That's a good thing. That you've now demonstrated that, at least as an individual, that you can recover from this virus. So that's psychologically some confidence. I think that the bigger question ultimately is, even if you've been exposed, you don't have antibodies, your body still has the capacity to really fire up antibodies again after an exposure. So maybe you're not seeing the antibodies when you measure it in people's blood, but clearly, upon a re-exposure, they're able to mount a response and not get sick again.